Hello, it's Willie Basse. What's happening?
How you doing, Willie?
I'm doing great, man.
Awesome.
Hey, thanks for calling us back again today. We'll just call yesterday the pre-interview to the interview.
Awesome.
So, obviously, you guys just got back from Europe, and how was your trip? And tell us a little bit about what that was like.
Yeah, it was just great. You know, we played over in near Amsterdam in the Netherlands, just about an hour from Amsterdam, and that was sweet. And then we went over to Paris, and we played in Switzerland.
Wow.
Switzerland was completely awesome, just a great venue. And, you know, Terry, the singer, Terry, you know, he speaks fluent French. So when we played in Paris, like, he didn't, like, you know, speak the entire show in French or anything, but, he could speak to the crowd and they acknowledged, you know, a few lines that he said because he knows language so well. And including when we played in Spain also, he knows Spanish really good. So that's kind of cool, you know. But the fans are just amazing over there. You know, they're so loyal. I don't really feel like they follow trends so much the way we do here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, nothing can swim by and just change the face of the earth over there as far as musically. So, you know, the fans were all there. You know, they have the American flags with our name on it.
Wow.
You know, they chant, you know, like Dirty D's Done Dirt Cheap, you know, while you're playing. They're like, hey, 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 hey. You're like, whoa, cool. This is cool, you know.
Wow.
So we just really enjoyed ourselves over there. You know, Germany's always amazing. Every time we played Germany, it's always been great. You know, we did all the old Monsters of Rock tours over there and stuff, and those fans are also hardcore and dedicated. I mean, they're so loyal.
Wow. Now,
they
great.
They really take big chances over there as far as, you know, the bands that they put together. I remember we played with Black Sabbath, you know, Slayer, and Bob Dylan, like all on the same stage, you know what I mean?
Wow.
Like Buddy Guy, you know,
wow.
Buddy Guy and Slayer. I mean, what promoter over here would take chances like that, you know
wow.
what I mean?
That's awesome. Because they're cross promoting and that's really powerful, you know. That's
and the fans went just as nuts for Slayer as they did Bob Dylan. You know what I mean?
Cool.
It's like they're just into the music. I mean, we just played over there a couple of years ago, and the band that played before us was called Iced Earth.
Yeah.
These guys are like, every song is like Kill Your Parents, you know, double kick, million miles an hour, we're just flying.
Yeah.
And we go out there, you know, do our straight ahead rock and roll, and they went just crazy, you know.
Cool.
So it's kind of neat in that sense, as far as Europe goes.
That's really cool to hear and very inspiring, because you wonder, yeah. You know. So you guys have a new album out, Elation, and you produced it. Is that correct?
Yeah, you know, Michael Lardy has been engineering and producing most of our records. And the last time I was involved in any production as far as Great White goes was on Once Bitten, the album with Rock Me. And
what a great, great song.
That.
What a great song.
Way back when. and I just kind of backed off from that, you know, and just would rather just play guitar and, you know, make comments and stuff, but not have to have my mind going in a million different directions.
Mm-hmm.
So, but, you know, in my spare time, I produce a lot of bands. Like, I produced three or four bands in the past couple of years, just doing records and stuff.
I didn't know that.
And I just felt that, you know, I asked Michael if, what would he think about me kind of getting involved with the production, because I just really, you know, I wanted the record to be really great, and I just thought it'd be good for him to have an extra pair of ears and get involved on the production end.
Mm-hmm.
And so I did, and it was a great team effort. The whole band was involved in the whole recording process. I mean, usually in the past, you know, if a drummer, you know, if Audie's done with his parts or whatever, he disappears for a couple of weeks, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But in this album, every band member was there for every minute of the recording. You know, they were there every day. You know, it was a total group effort as far as the writing, you know, and it was just, we just really enjoyed ourselves, man.
That's
we
pretty
really
cool.
We really had a good time.
Man, you know, Terry came by and played me some mixes, and when I heard them, I was like, wow, you know, I miss, you know, people just don't make records like this anymore. You know, it was just a good, solid, straight-ahead, real album.
Yeah, we were really excited, too, and we recently, we have a single coming out called Hard to Say Goodbye. It's a ballad, and we felt that the mix could be a little better, and so we brought in a really well-known producer named George Tutko, who's, you know, he's done basically Rod Stewart's entire career, John Cougar Mellencamp, Bob Seger, you know, the list just goes on and on and on and on.
Yeah, Tutko's awesome.
He mixed one song, and we were so pleased with the mix that we asked if he would mind remixing our whole album, and that's what he's doing right now.
Cool.
So so that's really exciting, you know, to have his, you know, to have him involved with the production team here and to have the extra ears and his experience and everything.
So,
you
so
know,
the,
we're
the...
pretty much at these days are like, what can we do to make the band better? We don't care about our egos or, you know,
that's cool.
Or whatever. So, that's exciting to have him involved as well.
So, the three mixes that you sent me, those are Tutko mixes?
Those are all his mixes.
Cool,
yes.
Cool.
So far he's done Love Train, Hard to Say Goodbye, and I've got something for you.
Awesome. Now, did you do a, because I mean, you did a video for the first single. Is there a video on this second single?
Yes. We were over in Florida filming it, and we've just kind of, the whole band has kind of approved the video editing. So now they're just doing the, you know, the color changes and effects and whatnot. But all the, you know, the video looks really good and everything. So we're going to the radio, I believe, next week.
Awesome.
With the new song. So
you guys
exciting.
Have had so many hits, man. I, you know, had the privilege of seeing you guys at the Key Club, and I had forgotten. It was just like hit after hit after hit after. I mean, you've got 12 studio albums, and, you know, I mean, the hits just kept coming.
a lot of studio albums. You know, it's funny because, you know, we changed the set around live and stuff, and still at a meet and greet, somebody will say, hey, well, how come you didn't play, you know, they'll just come with some obscure song, you know what I mean? It's like, okay, you know, so... It's hard, you know. I mean, we don't go out and do the Bruce Springsteen four-hour shows, you know. So, but we try to, you know, we try to play everything that everybody wants to hear and stuff, and just kind of mix it up and keep it fresh for us. So we're anything to eliminate going through the motions. We do that.
That's cool.
You know what I mean?
So obviously, your influences are the 70s, you know, the 60s and 70s guys. But didn't you do some recent shows with ZZ Top or a
well,
show?
You know, yeah, you know, when I was a really young teenager, I was, for some reason, I was just like completely blown away by like Creedence Clearwater, and I loved Santana. I mean, I was so into Santana. I thought Carlos Santana was like God or something.
I think,
you know?
He's close.
I was in a band, and we didn't even consider ourselves a tribute band, but we played all Santana. You know what I mean? So it was crazy. I mean, I loved him so much, and I think that was kind of my first step toward people who play with a lot of feeling. I got into more guitar players that really I felt just the way they squeeze notes and stuff, that's what inspired me to play. And Billy Gibbons was one of them.
Yep. That first album, man.
Years.
That first album just blew me. It just blew me off the planet. But you know, Fogerty's no chump on guitar, man. And his songwriting is amazing. You know, John,
are you talking about Billy Gibbons?
No, John Fogerty, Credence. That stuff, I mean.
Credence, yeah.
I was in
Credence
high school, but I love those guys.
One of the most amazing, you know, John Fogerty. That's one of the most incredible bands, songwriting-wise, that I've ever heard in my life. We've done some shows with, you know, the Revisited band or whatever. I think it's only, like, I believe the bass player and drummer or something, the original members. But, my God, you talk about a set list, bro. I mean, it's like, I mean, you know, you go from Suzy Q to, you know, I mean, it just goes on and on. It'd be like us playing, like, Rock Me every song, you know what I mean, or even better than that, you know. It's crazy. It's like every single song they play was a massive hit at some point.
Yeah, they're packing hits.
So imagine having a set list that strong. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah, yeah. So touring has been good, and they love you. I mean, it's like the response that I've gotten, just, you know, letting the world know that we were going to be doing this has been overwhelming. I mean, I looked today, and we had 260 likes just on my Willie Basse page, just saying, you know, mentioning that we were going to be doing this. So I'm really grateful that you took time out of your busy schedule to get with us. And you know, I mean, we go back.
We go way back. Yeah, you know, we're so blessed. I mean, you know, to have a new singer and have the, you know, our fans be so accepting and just loving it, you know.
Yeah.
It makes us feel really good. And, you know, the live shows have just been just crazy good, you know. It's just, we have a new energy. It's just so great. You know, the singer, Terry just goes out and just kills it every night. I mean, he sings perfect. I mean, even on our album, we didn't use any auto-tuning, which is almost unheard of. Usually you'll fix a word here or there,
yeah,
you know, but
yeah. The
guy, he has just this perfect pitch, you know. I mean, we would redo lines while he was recording, like, oh, I think you can get that better, or why don't you try this?
Mm-hmm.
But he just nails. He's a really good musician. But yeah, about us going back, we sure do go back, Willie. I know Black Sheep. I remember you guys. I mean, we all started around the same time, and you know, with back in the Dante Fox days, and Black Sheep, we were all doing the same circuit. And man, those days were electric. You know.
Yeah.
I just remember going to Hollywood, and the music scene was so alive, and it's. Great to the memories from back then, you know.
Yeah, it was a good time to come up. Did you ever play a club called the Rock Corporation? Do you remember that place?
The Rock Corporation.
It was a biker bar on Van Nuys and Oxnard.
I don't believe I ever played that. I swear we frequented it. We would play either the Starwood, the Whiskey, the Troubadour, or we would play like the Woodstock.
The Woodstock, oh
or
my God.
Or we would play, which is in Anaheim in Orange County.
Yeah, I remember.
Or we would play, like, these little halls or in someone's backyard. that was our circuit. We, you know, there was a few clubs. I remember one called the Wood Sound.
Monrovia.
Area.
Yeah, yeah.
We used to play that
wow.
one. And there was another one. In Glendora, I forgot, it was some other club. But, we, you know, there was other clubs we played, but the ones in Hollywood was Troubadour, Whiskey, Starwood.
Man,
I don't really
times.
Remember playing too many other venues, apart from when we started to come up a little more. We played, what's that theater over there?
Oh, Perkins Palace?
The Palace.
Yeah, that was great, man. Dante Fox was a great band. You guys kicked ass, man. I remember that. Yeah.
The Palace, when we started to get more of a following, that's when we, I think we were getting a little bit of airplay.
Yeah.
With our demo record, our little five-song EP.
Wow.
It was a record. It was five songs, and on both sides we had the same songs. So if one song, one side wears out, you always get side two. That was crazy because we really didn't have a proper record deal. I mean, it wasn't like we were on a major label or anything. We were just had Green World distribution. We weren't even on Enigma.
It was
just
Green
our
World.
Own label.
Yeah.
And somehow our manager called us, Alan Niven, one day and said, listen to KMET at this certain time. And my thinking was that they were had some ad for a show we were playing or something. And all of a sudden they play Down on Your Knees, and I'm thinking it's just one time only, but then all of a sudden they keep playing it. It's like in this like rotation vibe.
What a song.
I'm going, this is crazy. This is like unheard of.
What a song. That was a great song, dude. Yeah,
that
I love
that.
That
was really something, and I remember when we started getting that airplay, it really started to create, you know, people talking around LA, well, what's with this airplay bit?
Yeah, exciting.
And so that was pretty exciting. And I remember we played the Troubadour, and Jim Gandy, you know,
was
there.
Wow.
And I don't even know why he was at our show, but he was there. He's probably playing a show somewhere in LA or something. And he came up to us and he says, that song On Your Knees, I think that can go national.
From the man himself.
Yeah, that's verbatim, word for word, what he said to us. And I go, that's cool. Jim Dandy's the bomb, man.
For
him to say something good about this little band, you know, it's pretty neat. You know?
Well, I mean, everything's kind of come full circle. I mean, you guys have had the mega record deals. You know, you spend a test of time. You march right through that grunge period where everything kind of went through a low. But then you got a deal with Kolodner, and that was really cool. But, I mean, now it's kind of like you're your own record label, so it's shifted back to sort of like it was in the green world days, right? I mean,
you
kind of measure your own destiny.
You know, the whole thing now is, you know, our MTVs are no longer there. You know, our MTV is YouTube.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly.
And
which is cooler.
The airplay that we get is like from, you know, the cable, the
internet.
Cyrus, mm-hmm. Boneyard. What do you call
the
it?
Sirius, the cable,
the satellite radio.
Yeah.
And then a lot of secondary markets that play, you know, the internet radio and stuff like that. And
mm-hmm.
because most of the stations like KLOS is more like Tom Petty 1982, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't really play current music from bands of our era, except for our older hits and stuff. But that's okay because, I mean, we still do shows with KLOS and stuff like the Rock Line, or, you know, we'll do a benefit. Maybe they'll get involved and stuff like that. So we try to do shows with the station just to, you know, let people know we're still here or whatever.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I just like, you know, to get our music to the people any way we can. So all our music's available on the download sites and, the, you know, all the, you know, iPod people, you know, we've got to make it available for them.
Cool, man. So you guys are with a new label as Frontiers, but I understand you've done a couple albums or three albums with them.
Yeah, we've done three albums with them. The difference being now, instead of like, you know, the U.S. having a deal and Japan having a deal and then doing a deal with Europe with Frontiers, we were talking to Mr. Serafino, who's the main guy at the label, and he's a huge fan of just our era. And he's like John Kolodner. He feels it died before it was supposed to. And he still feels it's viable. He loves our new music. And so our idea was, instead of just you being a territory label for us, why don't we do the whole world with you And that way we know what we're doing all the time instead of, you know, having to call this guy and that guy and what's your plan, what's his plan, and, you know.
Yeah.
We it's much easier when you just have one label for the world because you can really stay on the same page on a day-to-day basis, you know.
Well, thank God for people like that, you know, that still believe, you know, and that
yeah,
are willing.
Yeah, it's a blessing.
To...
I mean, Jack Blades has an album. And I mean, I don't know, bands like Journey and stuff like that are, you know, just a lot of, you know, he signs a lot of bands from our era and they still make great music. I mean, I was listening to a couple of Jack Blades tracks and they're killer.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, that guy is a songwriting machine. Man.
Oh, yeah, he's a great songwriter.
So these guys are still playing good. They're still writing good. So, you know, and I know, you know, I can speak for myself, but I'm sure other guys like Jack Blades feel the same way. What keeps you going is to be creative.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what keeps our wheels going and keeps our energy alive is, you know, because we don't want to be an oldies band. We like to make new music. We love to play our old music, but, to keep it fresh for us, which is pretty important, it's like you want to keep, you know, you keep making new music, you know.
That's awesome. Man, so new album, you know, great mixes by Mr. Tutko, killer label. Wow, it's just awesome. Now, I was doing a little bit of research and noticed that you guys have sold somewhere in the neighborhood of 25 million records, dude. That's like, I mean, if I'd have told you that back in the day.
Yeah, we sold 20,000 records back in our day. We sold just a little more than 100,000 when we went out on tour with Judas Priest on our very first album.
Yeah.
And it was like, you know, even though it was a, you know, two albums with an option, they were going to do nothing. EMI America was going to do nothing with
right.
our second record whatsoever.
Right.
So we had to part ways with them because if you don't sell at least 150,000 or 200,
yeah,
it's like they just, it's not happening.
Right.
So we didn't really have any big radio hits. Even though Stick It was a kind of a hit within our fan base,
mm-hmm.
it wasn't a big national, you know, smash or anything. And our MTV play was more like 4 in the morning vibe. So it just wasn't what they expected sales-wise. And so we had to go back to the grind and do what we do and just kind of put our own record out again. So we made our own record. And for some unknown reason, some Capitol people came down to a show who was the father company of EMI America. That's the strange part.
Right.
So you basically get dropped off a label, and the main company, Capitol, who's the father company to EMI America, signs the band. It's like it was almost weird. It was surreal. But, you know,
meant
we were
to
fine
be.
With it, you know, and then we got to go in and make a record instead of having to prove ourselves and make a demo or something.
Mm-hmm.
We were able to make a record from scratch for a major label, and that was really sweet. And we were coming up with some pretty good music. You know, we had Rock Me and Lady Red Light and those songs. And luckily for us, I mean, when you have no track record of, you know, any hits whatsoever, and you put out a 7-minute song for your first single, it's a little risky.
Yeah, it's
I
risky.
I mean, you know, it wasn't like we were, you know, it wasn't like we were, you know, some huge artist that had hit after hit that can get away with that. But for
mm-hmm.
some reason, we got away with it. You know, luckily for us, because I felt like it was a little scary to put out a song that was 7 minutes, but.
Well, it was a good song,
it worked,
and
so
it's kind of like when you heard that, you didn't want it to end. So, for me, I loved it. You know?
Yeah, I mean, I think the dynamics of the song is
yeah.
what made it be okay to be that long, you know, because
mm-hmm.
it's not like we were Phil Collins, you know, coming out with this,
I didn't notice that. I never really noticed that it was that long until you just now mentioned it.
Yeah, it's 7 minutes, but, you know, I think, like I said, if it was just slamming all the way through and it was 7 minutes, then it might, you know, luckily it had these
peaks and valleys.
You know, kind of the shock value of dynamics, like where it's screaming along, and then all of a sudden it drops into nothing.
Yeah.
And, you know, so it keeps your attention. It takes you
somewhere.
And that's why I think it worked. But I guess sometimes you got to take risks like that to gain anything. So I'm happy we did that and everything.
Well, real quickly, while I got you on the phone, tell us that Slayer story again, because got to get that in there.
Oh, Slayer. Oh, you mean way back in the day? Yeah. Well, you know, I was telling you, you know, I was just online, you know, just surfing up, kind of out of boredom, and I noticed that the Woodstock, where we used to play, not the big Woodstock concert in New York.
No, the club.
But the Woodstock Concert Theater in Orange County had a website, and I went on this website, and I'm going, holy cow, man, I remember all these bands, and because we played with them all, you know, some kind of went off and did good things, and some, you know, we don't know what happened to them, but
I just remember playing
a lot of shows, you know, the owners, Joe Schultz or whatever, they basically adopted us. I mean, we're like the house band there, we play there every other week, and, you know. Yeah. We had this little following and stuff, and it was, you know, it was really great, gracious of them. They let us rehearse in the building next to it and everything. So we were, you know, like I said, like a house band, and we had a lot of bands that went on to do great things, and Slayer was one of them.
Unbelievable.
And Slayer, they were just your average hair band. I mean, they were, you know, basically Bon Jovi. I mean, they, you know, their music was very safe. There was nothing super heavy about it. Well, one day I remember coming into the building and we were playing with Slayer. And I'm almost sure it was the drummer that came up to me, because I go, dude, they all looked like Rob Halford, you know, in his, you know, most sadistic moment, you know, with the armbands, with the spikes, and, you know, and I thought it was kind of early in the day to be wearing this stuff, you know, but the drummer comes up to me and he says, I go, so, wow, looks like you guys robbed the pleasure chest or something, you know, I go, his words to me were, we turned metal, like it's just, like it's something you just do, you know. Like we were Bon Jovi, but now we're like, you know, killer death metal, you know. But the good news for them is they did it really good.
Yeah, and it worked.
And before you knew it, they weren't even around anymore. They had the energy and the drive to go over to Europe and go to England, and they just played over there like silly, and they were just huge over there. People loved them.
Yeah.
And they just got better and better and better, almost like the early days of Metallica.
Right.
I mean, if you saw Metallica in 1979, 1980, whatever it was, and when they used to play in L.A.
Well, no, they played those clubs, too.
They weren't that good.
I remember them playing the City Limits.
And I don't mean that in a bad way, because they had just as much drive as Slayer or any of us. If not more. You know, they wanted to make it more than anything.
Yeah.
And they've just improved so much musically over the years and everything. Like Hetfield is just, to me, an absolute monster singer. I mean,
I love
him. If I had to rate him as a singer, it would be a 10.
Yeah.
His energy is so amazing. And, you know, it's just that, you know, growing up around that era, you wouldn't really figure, you know, who can, I don't know these guys that can just go see a band that needs to be developed, but just goes, oh, they're going to be huge. You know, I don't know if I could be an A&R guy. I don't know if I could see through all that, but man, did they ever take off and stick to their hearts and do, and, do really well. So,
well, yeah, you would tell them the story about
to be involved in that era, like to see bands like Slayer, and then years later playing huge festivals with Slayer in them. You know, it's really neat.
Well, you were saying you guys opened for U2 or something, and it was like 10 or 12 people there.
No, actually, we were just there. We used to hang out there too, during the week, we're just a hang, because we lived like 3 blocks from the Woodstock.
Yeah.
So we would go there and then drink beer and just hang out. Well, one night there's this band from all the way from Ireland. I remember the flyers and everything, all the way from Ireland.
I remember that.
Right?
Yeah.
But we have no clue who they are or do we care. We're not even paying attention.
Yeah.
There's 11 people total in the building. You know, it holds like we used to cram like 500 people in that room.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, so there's 11 people. You know, 4 of them are playing pinball machines. The other ones are not even paying attention. I paid attention because the power kept going out, and I was shocked on how low their stage volume was, but how great they sounded when the PA was on. I'm going, that really kind of put a light in my head. I go, we should maybe turn down a little bit, still get our tone, but when we're playing these small venues, it might be an idea, because it makes the house sound so good when you're, but when you're young, you think the louder my amp is, the ballsier I'm going to be, and I'm the greatest guitar player in the world, so I know everything, right? But the truth of the matter is, every time the power went out, of course, it was a nightmare. I mean, this bear,
oh my God, I remember him.
And receive the power. it was terrible, but it couldn't have been longer than a year after that where they had New Year's Day and they were the biggest thing on the planet, but I'll just never forget that, seeing a band so big. And I know bands like The Police and all those, a lot of big bands.
I was at Madam Wong's when The Police pulled up in a U-Haul truck, man. No one knew who they were. It was like Wong's Chinatown, Police U-Haul truck.
Like everybody's got to start somewhere. I mean, the first time I saw Van Halen play was in a backyard in El Monte, 3 blocks from my house. My friend had seen him like once or twice already. He kept telling me how great, you're not going to believe this guitar player, and it's like pretty cool. So he goes, now you got no excuse. They're playing 3 blocks away. So we paid her $1. And I'll never forget, when I walked into this party and Van Halen was playing, the drummer was playing a solo, and Dave Roth was doing some kind of wipeout type of deal on his floor tom, and Dave Roth was blowing a tube into the drum to make the pitch go up and down, And that was my very first witnessing of Van Halen. I go, okay, yeah, I remember that song, Wipeout. Okay, what's the big deal, But of course, the guitar player ends up blowing me away. And they did a lot of cover songs. And I remember they did play a couple originals.
Mm-hmm.
And, the singer was like, had the big attitude. And he was all like, I remember, I just liked the vibe of the band. It was really cool. I started following them around a little bit. I mean, it was like, guitar player is pretty amazing. And, the music scene just around the Inland Empire was so electric. There were so many bands, and there was a lot of like backyard party activity that seemed to be kind of the, we needed a place to play. Not everybody played, maybe play a club every once in a while, but it was like these backyard parties were like
keg parties, man.
Infamous. I mean, you go, you charge at the door $1, and you go play at somebody's party. But it was a pretty neat time. That Van Halen, watching them grow into something, and then every time a big band would come through, UFO or Santana or something, it was always Van Halen that opened. So it was kind of neat to watch them, actually get a record deal. Because when they got a record deal, I was like the happiest man on the planet. I go, just to know that it can happen.
Yeah.
It didn't even seem like to me like it was possible for a local band to get a record deal. When they got a record deal, I go, oh my God, you know, it gives you hope. It's like it could really happen, you know. I mean, that, I was really happy for them.
Yeah, I was happy too. I was out with Buddy Miles, and we heard the song, what the Kink song, "You Really Got Me," on the radio. I think we were in New Orleans or something, and I was like, "They got signed." It was like, cool.
You know, there's a story about that song. Yeah, Danny Allen had been doing that song for years, and when they recorded it, the band was told not to play it for anybody, you know, and all this stuff. And Eddie went to a party and was playing it for all these people, and supposedly guys from the band Angel were there. And they went and tried to record it and release it before Van Halen. This is the story I've heard.
Oh my God.
I'm not saying it's positively true or whatever, but they ended up having to release that song like a month before the album came out just so they could get their staple on it.
Wow.
But that's a rumor I've heard, you know. Like I said, I'm not saying it's 100% true, but that was kind of floating around for a few years.
Punky Meadows.
Funky Meadows,
man.
Yeah, Angel. Yeah. I remember that, man. I remember we played we used to play this place called the Capri Theater, like it was in the West Covina area.
Uh-huh.
And we played a band. Do you remember the band The Dogs?
Oh, yeah, I know, Lauren.
The Dogs.
The Dogs,
know?
With the girl bass player.
I just remember them and Angel. Angel was kind of a big deal.
Oh, my God. Yeah, Lauren's still around. The Dogs live. They're on my Facebook.
The Dogs.
Yeah,
girl.
Lauren. I think Lauren's.
You know, these fans that when you're back then, you know, the Dogs. They're like, this is a huge band. I mean, you just think they're big. Like they just seem like professional or something.
Yeah.
But when you look back, you're going, whoa, man. You know, dude, I have a lot to learn. But I mean, I'm not saying they weren't great or whatever. But it's just, you know, you're thinking it just changes. You know.
Well, you know, Lauren went on to do Little Caesar. They had a hit for a minute there, you know, which was really cool.
And the keyboard player from Angel, Jafria, went on to play with a few different things.
House of Lords, yeah.
House of Lords, and, you know, so he had some good music. I've heard he's a businessman that's done really well.
Mr. Hard Rock, or what was it, Hard Rock Cafe, or... One of the Hard Rock, something about the Hard Rock. Because I replaced their, when they got the new bass player, I replaced him in the band he was in. So it was kind of cool. I knew all this trivia. One time I got him on the phone and I started asking him all these trivia questions. He couldn't believe I knew so much about Angel.
I know. Well, I know you, and you're a, you know, connoisseur of music, your whole life's music, and I know you. Probably know more than I do.
I wouldn't go that far, but you know, I was. You mentioned Manichetti and Y&T. They were yesterday and today, and I was actually there when they rolled up to the record plant to do their demos with Lee Kiefer, who had done the Tubes. And I'll never forget it because they had three stacks in the organ. They had a pipe organ at the record plant, and in the organ chamber. Manichetti had three stacks of Marshalls. I was like, whoa, three stacks. What are they doing? And he was like, dude, that's the only way to make it sound like a wall of Marshalls is to have a wall of Marshalls.
That's awesome. Yeah, you know, I remember when Yesterday and Today used to come and play the Starwood, and they had that,
so
that
good.
Big old black, like, I think it was black. I don't know. It looked like the Partridge Family bus. It wasn't like a tour bus. It was like, I think it had windows on it. But
yeah.
I remember thinking, how professional can you be, man, to have your own bus? I mean, that is, like, incredible, you know. But, yeah, it's amazing. In fact, I just played a show with Tesla, and I was talking with Frank, and he has just done this record, and he got a bunch of guitar players to play on it, and Manichetti was one of them.
Cool.
It's called Six String Soldiers, and he's going to do another one. He said I could play in the next one, but...
cool, man.
Yeah, Manichetti is he's a beast, man. Oh. He's a really good player.
Unbelievable.
In fact, a lot of the venues that we've just played over in Europe, you know, Y&T go over there and just play... They play silly. I mean, they do long tours in Europe.
Yeah.
They really like to get out there and play Europe a lot. So that's really, I'm glad to see him still plugging away. He's always been a great. I used to love that Leonard Hayes. He was such a great drummer, man.
Woo-hoo, yeah.
Remember that guy?
He had a 28-inch bass drum, the big bass drum. Yeah, I remember that guy.
He is an amazing drummer. I think that they got, when they got rid of him, I don't even think it was a musical or I think they're going for, because he really didn't have, if they're going for the pretty boy image, then that's probably what they did, because if drumming-wise, he was just awesome.
Yeah, he was the shit.
I do remember that.
Hey, so now you've got some gigs coming up this weekend. We want to give a little bit of notice to the fans. You're playing a casino this weekend, or what are the gigs?
I'll give you the details on that in just a second. Okay. We got two shows coming up in Oregon.
Awesome.
And one show is in Washington, and I'm going to tell you where those. I'm going to give you the heads up on that.
It's so exciting! You guys are playing and out there making the rounds.
We're actually playing with our old friend Vince Neil on the first couple shows.
Oh, cool, cool.
Which it's really cool, I've known Vince for so long. But the first show we're playing the two nights at the Chinook Winds Casino with Vince Neil, and that's in Lincoln City, Oregon.
Awesome.
And then we're doing a show on our own. And that's going to be at it's called the DNR Theater, and that's in Aberdeen, Washington.
Awesome, man.
So, yeah, we got that coming up on the 2nd, 3rd, and 4th. But I remember I was in a band, this was years ago. I mean, I could have been more than 17 years older, and
just
it was called Zizzix.
Yeah, Zizzix, man.
I remember playing at Charter Oak High School at lunchtime, and that's the first time I ever saw Vince Neil, Vince Warden or whatever. But because all my buddies went to that school and they knew him, and then a couple years or a year or so later, I was in this battle of the bands, and he was in this other band. But my friends had told me, he would sing just in the air. But not with the band or anything, but, he'd be at a party and just start singing to you. But he was not even jamming with anybody or anything. And then all of a sudden he's in a band singing. So, and I remember because it was a battle of the bands, and my band came in 4th place, I believe, and his came in 3rd.
Unbelievable.
One of my really good friends, Dave Alverson's younger brother, who I didn't even know he had a brother, but his name is James Alverson. He was the guitar player in that band called Rock Candy.
Rock Candy, wow.
Rock Candy.
I didn't know that was
dude.
Vince. Yeah. I remember them.
And I guess, they actually played around a little bit, and I think that's how Vince got discovered. I think, either the bass player or somebody from Motley Crue actually saw him sing and stole him out of that band.
Unbelievable. Funny. Tales from the Sunset Strip.
I've had people steal my singers too before. Back in Dante Fox, we used to have a chick singer named Lisa Baker.
Mm.
And George Lynch took her out of my slipped her out of the band. I got another singer named Butch Say after that, but he was more like Rob Halford kind of singer. But she was a really good singer, and she joined George Lynch had a band called Exciter.
I remember Exciter, yeah, but I didn't know that's where the girl came from.
She sang in that band, and he actually had that song In the Middle, which ended up being on a Dawkins' first album.
Had no idea.
George Lynch song.
Had no idea that's where she came from. Wow. Cool.
Yeah.
Learning a lot here.
History.
Mr. Mark Kendall. Mark Kendall.
George Lynch actually was doing the right hand tapping kind of thing before I ever saw Eddie do it. And I actually saw Eddie a lot back then, and I never saw him do the eruption thing with his right hand back then.
Yeah, it's funny that...
But Lynch was doing it, but he always faced his amp like he didn't want anybody to know what he was doing or something.
Well, I think there was a guy named...
Lynch's thing, he never did anything like totally musical, like it wasn't like an orchestrated piece of music or anything. Mm-hmm. It was just like, it just sounded like a zillion notes going on. You really didn't know what he was up to, but...
It's funny that Eddie got the credit for all of that.
That band, The Boys, they were
called The Boys. Yeah, I remember them too, yeah.
Yeah, and Lynch, remember Lynch was in that band,
yeah. Yeah, yes, I think Terry Kilgore was the guy that kind of like brought that in, but George, was doing it, but Eddie got the credit, so what are you going to do, you know?
Well, he turned it into something musical, you know, and he's just so good. I mean, people don't realize that they probably do realize it, I'm just bringing it out, is his right hand is, like, pretty incredible.
Yeah.
I mean, the way he picks notes, it's a lot of practice, you know? I know he practiced more than everyone, and that's probably why he's better, plus his natural gift or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But I know he practiced just, you know, every day, I mean, for hours and hours. I remember their sound man, I was at this apartment one time, and he had a whole box of tapes. He used to work for Van Halen, like he was their sound man for the first couple tours. And he gave me some tapes of their demos that they did for Ted Templeman and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And, the versions ended up a little bit different. You heard, things cut out. But I guess Ted Templeman just had them play all their originals just live, in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
They might have overdubbed some vocals or something, but it was pretty much a straight head. And I just remember all those songs. It was just incredible. There's still songs that haven't been released, but he gave me this one tape, and it was like Eddie, like in his bedroom or something. And you can actually hear Somebody Give Me a Doctor develop, like the initial riff.
Wow.
And that stuff is now on YouTube after all these years. Like, I don't know how those tapes got out, but I never, like, I let Tracy, Grijalva, Tracy G, hear it, and a few close friends, but I wasn't even making copies for people, because don't make any copies of this and that. I stayed true and didn't,
Yeah, I've got a tape of them.
I'm playing for people, but... It's just amazing, but you really hear, the guy just... Every time I thought I was getting a little better on guitar, I'd go see him play, and it was just so disheartening. it just seemed like, it seemed like he got better,
Yeah. Molasses, dude. You got that sweet touch, That stuff is special that you do. You got the icing on the cake.
I have definitely a different look, I got the melodic thing, and I hear things in my head and stuff, but there's no denying, man, when there's a monster, I'll be the first one to bow.
Yeah, plus you got the shark guitar. I just love that guitar, man.
Oh, the shark. Yeah, it's funny about the shark. Years ago, it started out with BC Rich. We got the idea to do a shark, but it ended up looking a little closer to Flipper than a shark. So I don't know how they did that. I swear it looked just like Flipper.
Oh,
but I went to this guy, J-Frog, who he had built, Lynch's Skull and Crossbones guitar, and he was kind of this very creative dude. I think he worked on like movie sets and stuff.
Uh-huh.
And very, very good artist. But anyways, he just disappears into his garage for like 6 days and comes out with something incredible. But he said he could do a proper shark for me. And it ended up looking like, Jaws, and it was really cool. Somehow creative, he made it look like a guy completely got swallowed by this thing, because he had like a band-aid on the knee, like the neck was a leg. It looked like the shark just swallowed this guy, you know.
Oh.
So that was really cool. And their headstock was, you know, like a PF Flyer tennis shoe.
Oh, wow.
So it was pretty cool. It was like the whole body got eaten. This guy's legs just sticking out of the mouth, you know. So that was pretty cool. And it didn't play that good, though. It was very hard to play. You know, I kind of did it out of mercy, you know, just so the kids could see something live and you know, so I'd break it out for like one song. So
it's evolved.
Later,
this guitar has evolved over the years.
Yeah, Ed Roman from Las Vegas, you know, we were talking about it, and he goes, you still got that shark. And what happened was Dick Clark had called our offices years ago and says, I need that shark guitar for my Hard Rock Cafe. And, you know, we just instantly gave it to him. It's like, you know, you don't want to say no to Dick Clark for anything. So we did give it to him. But, you know, we just got the idea to kind of bring the shark back. And this great, wonderful guitar maker named Michael Reisinger, we got together on the specs for my other guitar, this Quicksilver that he built me, and he did such a good job on that. I go, hey, can you make the shark sound good too? And he goes, I'll make it sound just like when you're playing. I go, God, if you can even get it close, I'll be happy.
Cool.
So we basically just built the head around the body of what I play. And, you know, it's light, it's not any big heavy thing, and plays great, and it actually looks really, really cool.
Yeah, it looks great. You look good holding it too, man, playing it.
Thanks, man.
Yeah,
appreciate
it.
So
we're gonna wrap it up, man. I mean, we could go on for days and days.
Oh yeah, but, yeah, we got so much history.
Yeah, I love it. I love
it.
We
were around the whole scene in the early '80s, and when Hollywood was just like screaming with bands. I mean, God, everybody under the sun was in a band, it seemed like.
Yep, the Dancing Waters Club.
Dancing Waters. I do remember that one.
My God. So, so man, we good luck on your date this weekend, and definitely give Mr. Alouse, Terry Alouse, the new vocalist, my best. And
thank you.
Man, my hat's off
to
you.
I sure will.
I really appreciate you talking to us, and we'll definitely keep in touch, man.
Okay, thanks, Will. I appreciate it, man. Nice, so good talking to you.
All right, God bless. Take care.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Mr. Mark Kendall from Great White, keeping it metal. Tales from the Sunset Strip.